If you have a function with a singular point, we can form an annulus around the singular point in which our function is analytic. For such a function, we have a Laurent series instead of a power series. And in this video, we'll learn why this is true. We'll see the proof of Laurent's theorem. So, as our z0, we will take 0 just to make the notation a bit easier, but the proof holds in general, of course. So, what's the construction? We know that our z is analytic between R1 and R2, capital R1 and capital R2, so the red circles in the figure, because we have our singular point at z0, so we have some annulus around it, in which f is analytic. Now, the figure you already see, you can choose small R1s and small R2s, which are slightly more inside. So the R2 is slightly smaller, small R2 is slightly smaller than the capital R2, and the small R1 is slightly bigger than the capital R1. So the blue circles, such that the f is analytic up inside and on the R1 and the R2s. So you have to choose slightly smaller circles because you want to ensure your function is not only analytic inside your circles, but also on the boundaries. So that's why you have to choose slightly smaller R1s and R2s. You have to go slightly inside your region. No problem, of course. And then you have some arbitrary z, and you draw some contour gamma around your z. Now, we know that if we draw a contour, we go around the small r1, the small r2, and around the gamma. So, for example, like this, you start going counterclockwise at your outer circle. You go in, for example, here. Then you go part clockwise around the gamma. You go inside towards the inner circle. You go all the way around clockwise the inner circle. You go back to your gamma circle, continue clockwise, and you go back over there. So you go counterclockwise around your outer circle, your R2 circle, and you go clockwise around your gamma 1 and your R1 circle. Then you know the contour consists of all those parts only goes around an analytic function. So there's a contour around C2, C1 and gamma together, that integral equals 0 because then the function is analytic. So the and this contour consists of three parts. All those parts going from circle to circle and going back, those cancel out. So your total contour consists of three parts. You go counterclockwise along your C2 and clockwise along the other one. So you add minus signs and total integral equals 0. Now, this last integral over here is up to a factor 2 pi I your f of z, because you go around your point, so you use this integral formula, so you know you're bringing this one and that one to the other side, that your f of z equals 1 over 2 pi I integral over C2 minus 1 over 2 pi I integral over C1. Now, this first integral, this one over here, along the outer one, that goes the same as in the case of your Taylor polynomial. That will just give you this first part, sum with the positive power, the n to the power n plus this remainder term. That's the one you already know. If you don't remember, just watch back this part about the Taylor series. And now we have a second contribution. This one from the C1. And that will give us our negative powers plus some sigma n of z, which will go to 0 if n goes to infinity. So now we focus on the second part, we focus on the new part. So what do we know? Well, on this inner circle, on this C1, we know that the norm of z is very far from the origin compared to what's happening here. So the norm of z is bigger than the norm of s. So we have this 1 over s minus z, or with an additional minus sign, minus 1 over s minus z. And we want to rewrite it in quotients of s over z, because s over z will be a small parameter. We want to expand in a small parameter. So minus 1 s over z, we can take out 1 over z equals 1 times 1 minus s over z. And now we use this familiar trick with the geometric series again. Sum n from 1 to capital N xi to the power n minus 1 equals first term minus last term divided by 1 minus xi. Like this, that's always true. It's only working, of course, if this xi is smaller than 1 in norm. So we can solve for 1 over 1 minus xi. It is your sum. And then you're just with this xi to the power n term, bring that to the right, like this. So you have left xi to the power capital N over 1 minus xi. So now you can rewrite your minus 1 over s minus z equals 1 over z times 1 over 1 minus s over z. So choose xi equals s over z. So you get the sum s over z to the power n minus 1. And the last term over here, s over z to the power capital N times 1 minus divided by 1 minus s over z. And then finally you bring in the 1 over z. So you get the s to the power minus n plus 1. If you bring it down, z 1 over z to the power n minus 1 times 1 over z equals 1 over z to the power n. And you just leave this part here and multiply the 1 over z to get a z minus s over here. So there we are. Now we have rewritten the minus 1 over s minus z into some sum and some remainder. And then we can rewrite the integral. The minus 1 over 2 pi times this integral equals, well, you just plug in the 1 over 2 pi. You can take this sum out because it's a finite sum, so you can always take it out. You have a 1 over z to the power n. It's not dependent of the integral. And a 1 over s to the power minus n plus 1, which comes here. Plus, again, a 1 over 2 pi. And then the integral of this part over here times f of s along c1. And that's exactly of the form bn over z to the power n, where the bn coefficients have this form, plus some remainder term with remainder f like that, which is exactly what we needed to show, because now you have that your function consists of two parts, an analytic part plus a remainder, plus a principal part plus a remainder, where you can show that those remainders go to zero if capital N goes to infinity, which means that you, if you take limits capital N to infinity, that your f of z consists of the part with the positive powers and the part with the negative powers.